Good morning, beloved. Happy Sabbath to you. May I have your permission behind the plexiglass here to take my mask off?
Yes.
Thank you. I am so excited. I've been looking forward to today for weeks. And Brother Stan has been behind the scenes putting this together. And if you have an opportunity after the service today to say, Stan, thank you so much for all you've done to put this wonderful program together, please do so. Brothers and sisters, do we have a mission?
Yes.
Do you feel called?
Yes.
We have a mission to share the love of Jesus Christ to this world during this dark time of these last ages on Earth's history. Yes?
Yes.
You know, it doesn't happen by just us sitting here doing nothing. Amen?
Yes.
We must act. And part of that act is supporting the ministry of the church, that we may fulfill our mission in carrying the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world. Yes?
Yes.
So we'd like to bring your attention to the screen back here, the announcement, and see where we are, where we have been with our church budget. And may I encourage you, as this annual year comes to an end, that we all say, what can I do to support the ministry of sharing the gospel of Christ's love to a dying world? What is my part, and can I support this? And so I would encourage you to join me in digging deep and providing for the ministry of this church. And I thank you in advance for that. To those of us who are joining us live on stream, we welcome you. We are glad that you're here. We hope you enjoy our program this morning. I have just a couple other things. If you will now turn your attention, a slide should be coming up regarding our nominating committee. We have made a few recommendations that we are going to be bringing to you for a vote next week. If we could bring up slide number 9. There we go. Thank you so much. This is our first reading. There will be a vote, as I said, next week. For elder, we have nominated Christy Bartlett, Rochelle Martling, Dennis Reed. For head deaconess, April McCorkle has been nominated. For assistant deaconess, Gay Flagel. Junior division, Kyle Craig. Primary division, Michelle Einig. So please consider these prayerfully next week. Again, these will come for a vote to you. If you desire in your giving, there will be probably Dwight. Will you be at the back door with an offering basket? Thank you, Brother Dwight over here. For those who would like to, if you have an offering or a tithe that you would like to share as you leave the service today, since due to COVID we're not passing the basket around, Dwight will be there. Otherwise, the online giving on our church website is super fantastic, easy as a way to support the ministry of this church. Thank you so much, beloved.
Good morning. As we had planned the program, we had planned to be able to sing because we had a window where our governor had asked us not to have church congregational singing, and then that window got extended. So because the window got extended, I thought, well, we can go back to a process that we used to do when maybe I was a little shorter than I am now, called congregational responsive reading. So on the slides, if you would take a look at that, the first slide will show us the hymn. One more. There we go. I don't have it, I'm sorry. And if you notice, the white text is for Rob and I as reader 1 and reader 2. And the yellow text is for the congregational responsive reading. So if you will all join us with that yellow text when that comes up, we'll do an old-fashioned congregational responsive reading. So, let's begin. Joy to the world, the Lord has come.
Let earth receive her king.
Let every heart prepare him room.
And heaven and nature sing.
And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world.
Joy to the earth. The Savior reigns.
Let men their songs employ.
While fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains.
Repeat the sounding joy.
Repeat
the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. No more let sin and sorrow grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow.
Far as the curse is found.
Far as the curse is found. Far as the curse is found.
He rules the world with truth and grace.
And makes the nations prove
the glories of his righteousness.
And wonders of his love.
And wonders of his love.
And wonders and wonders of his love. Thank you.
In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel. since I am a virgin?" The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be barren, is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her.
Strong. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken to the prophet. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus.
Could it be this baby in my arms, sleeping now so peacefully, the Son of God, the angel said, how could it be? How could it be?
At that time, Augustus Caesar sent out an order to all people in the countries that were under Roman rule. The order said that they must list their names in a register. This was the first registration taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own towns to be registered.
So Joseph left Nazareth, a town in Galilee. He went to the town of Bethlehem in Judea. His town was known as the town of David. Joseph went there because he was from the family of David. Joseph registered with Mary because she was engaged to marry him. Mary was now pregnant. Well, Joseph and Mary were in Bethlehem. The time came for her to have the baby. She gave birth to her first son. There was no room left in the inn, so she wrapped the baby with cloths and laid him in a box where animals are fed.
It was not a silent night. There was blood on the ground. You could hear a woman cry in the alleyways that night, on the streets of David's town. And the stable was not clean. Cobblestones were cold. A little Mary full of grace, with her tears upon her face, and her mother's hand to hold. It was a labor of pain. It was a cold sky above. Joseph by her side, calloused hands and weary eyes. There were no midwives to be found on the streets of David's town in the middle of the night. So he held her and he prayed. Shafts of moonlight on his face, but the baby in his womb, he was the maker of the moon. He was the author of the faith that could make the mountains beat of a beautiful heart. It was was a labor of love. For little Mary, full of grace, with the tears upon her face, it was a labor of love. It was not a silent night on the streets of David's town.
Now, there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I will bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger.
Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea. This happened while Herod was king of Judea. After Jesus' birth, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. They asked, "Where is this child who has been born to be king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose. Now we have come to worship him." When King Herod heard about it, he was very upset. Everyone in Jerusalem was troubled too. So Herod called together all the chief priests of the people. He also called the teachers of the law. He asked them where the Messiah was going to be born. In Bethlehem in Judea, they replied. This is what the prophet has written, he said. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are certainly not the least important among all the towns of Judah. A ruler will come out of you. He will rule my people Israel like a shepherd. Then Herod secretly called for the wise men. He found out from them exactly where the star had appeared. They sent them to Bethlehem. He said, go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me. Then I can go and worship him too. After the wise men had listened to the king, they went on their way. The star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them. It finally stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. The wise men went to the house. There they saw the child with his mother Mary. They bowed down and worshipped him. They opened their treasures. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Oftentimes, the words of a song start as the words of a poem. I personally am not a big fan of poetry. Maybe it's because I'm not good at it. But the words of this song intrigued me. I found words that we rarely use. At least, I don't use. I don't know. When was the last time you told your kids, hey, get your jackets. Let's get in the car. We're going to go to Traverse, yonder and far. So, with me, come on a short journey as we look at the words of this song. Okay, that kind of worked. We three kings. We three kings of Orient are. Who are these three kings? And what is Orient Tar? Did anyone as a small child get confused by some of the words of this song? Orient Tar. Bearing gifts we traverse afar. Few of us traverse today, and yet prior to COVID, many of us traveled long distances just for fun. Field and fountain, moor and mountain, traveling past and through fields and rivers, moors, the open, uncultivated areas of a country. Mountains. We know all about mountains here in the Pacific Northwest. Following yonder star. All following a yonder star. How many of us could travel using a star today? Many of us with our GPSs follow them in the wrong direction half the time. Born a king on Bethlehem's plain, gold I bring to crown him again. King forever, ceasing never, all us, over all us to reign. The duty of a king, a true king, is to care for his people, King Jesus. Frankincense to offer have I. Incense owns a deity nigh. Prayer and praising, all men raising. Worship him, God on high. Frankincense was a form of incense. A deity nigh means Christ was near. Prayers like incense smoke rising to heaven. Myrrh is mine, its bitter perfume. Myrrh and frankincense, what made them so unique? Where they came from, how they were acquired. Both of them are much like our maple syrup. You have to tap a tree and cause the resin to come out. And then it hardens, and then you have to collect it, and then you sort it. And depending on what color it is and the grade of it and all those kinds of things, can range anywhere from $150 a pound to $14 a pound if you look on Amazon. But at the time of Christ, it was valued greater because of the process of using it in their daily lives, much more than we do today. We recognize these as two of the gifts that the Magi brought. This slide is a little indicative of where that red dot, for those of you that can't see it on the internet, it's a slide of the Far East. And it shows Jerusalem. Bethlehem would be really near that red dot. The material in the upper right corner is frankincense. The lower left corner is myrrh. And then, of course, we recognize what gold looks like. So for the value of perfumes, of incense, of medicine, it was also used in the holy anointing of priests and kings. Breathes a life of gathering gloom. I'll go back and read the first line of that verse. Myrrh is mine, its bitter perfume. Breathes a life of gathering gloom. Sorrowing, sighing, bleeding, dying. Sealed in a stone-cold tomb. The poet in those three lines summarizes the life of Christ from the garden to the cross to the tomb. Glorious now, behold him arise, King and God and sacrifice. Alleluia, alleluia, sounds through the earth and skies. I came away from this little read amazed at the language, the words and what they represented, and when set to music, how concise the message of the song was. So much of the story told in four verses and a chorus. Verses and a chorus that we know the meaning of these words, like we understood the beauty of the song. Let's make sure our little ones, as they hear these words, know the meaning of the song.
Once upon a mountaintop, three little trees stood and dreamed of what they wanted to become when they grew up. The first little tree looked up at the stars twinkling like diamonds above him. "I want to hold treasure," he said. "I want to be covered with gold and filled with precious stones. I will be the most beautiful treasure chest in the world." The second little tree looked out at the small stream trickling by on its way to the ocean. "I want to be a strong sailing ship," he said. "I want to travel mighty waters and carry powerful kings. I will be the strongest ship in the world." The third little tree looked down into the valley below where busy men and busy women worked in a busy town. "I don't want to leave this mountaintop at all," she said. "I want to grow so tall that when people stop to look at me, they will raise their eyes to heaven and think of God." I will be the tallest tree in the world. Years passed, the rains came, the sun shone, and the little trees grew tall. One day, three woodcutters climbed the mountain. The first woodcutter looked at the first tree and said, "This tree is beautiful. It is perfect for me." With a swoop of his shining axe, the first tree fell. "Now I shall be made into a beautiful chest," thought the first tree. "I shall hold wonderful treasure." The second woodcutter looked at the second tree and said, "This tree is strong. It is perfect for me." With a swoop of his shining axe, the second tree fell. "Now I shall sail mighty waters," thought the second tree. "I shall be a strong ship, fit for kings." The third tree felt her heart sink when the last woodcutter looked her way. She stood straight and tall and pointed bravely to heaven. But the woodcutter never even looked up. "Any kind of tree will do for me," he muttered. With a swoop of his shining axe, the third tree fell. The first tree rejoiced when the woodcutter brought him to a busy carpenter shop. But the busy carpenter was not thinking about treasure chests. Instead, his work-worn hands fashioned the tree into a feed box for animals. The once beautiful tree was not covered with gold or filled with treasure. He was coated with sawdust and filled with hay for hungry farm animals. The second tree smiled, and when the woodcutter took him to a shipyard, but no mighty sailing ships were being made that day. Instead, the once strong tree was hammered and sawed into a simple fishing boat. Too small and too weak to sail an ocean or even a river, he was taken to a little lake. Every day, he brought in loads of dead, smelly fish. The third tree was confused when the woodcutter cut her into strong beams and left her in a lumber yard. "What happened?" the once tall tree wondered. "All I ever wanted to do was stay on the mountaintop and point to God." Many, many days and nights passed. The three trees nearly forgot their dreams. But one night, golden starlight poured over the first tree as a young woman placed her newborn baby in the feed box. "I wish I could make a cradle for him," her husband whispered. The mother squeezed his hand and smiled as the starlight shone on the smooth and sturdy wood. "This manger is beautiful," she said. And suddenly, the first tree knew he was holding the greatest treasure in the world. One evening, a tired traveler and his friends crowded into the old fishing boat. The traveler fell asleep as the second tree quietly sailed out into the lake. Soon a thundering and thrashing storm arose. The little tree shuddered. He knew he did not have the strength to carry so many passengers safely through the wind and rain. The tired man awakened. He stood up, stretched out his hand, and said, "Peace." The storm stopped as quickly as it had begun. And suddenly, the second tree knew he was carrying the King of Heaven and Earth. One Friday morning, the third tree was startled when her beams were yanked from the forgotten woodpile. She flinched as she was carried through an angry, jeering crowd. She shuddered when soldiers nailed a man's hands to her. She felt ugly and harsh and cruel. But on Sunday morning, when the sun rose and the earth trembled with joy beneath her, the third tree knew that God's love had changed everything. It made the first tree beautiful. It had made the second tree strong. And every time people thought of the third tree, they would think of God. that was better than being the tallest tree in the world.
We've already read this passage today, but just to recap, there are some shepherds out in the fields at night watching over their sheep. They were shepherds because that was their lot in life. While the rest of the family and older siblings slept in town, they had to keep an eye on the community's flock. Huddled around the fire that kept the chilly Judean air at bay, these teenagers listened for a movement among the sheep indicating any sort of trouble. These were probably young people, and the youngest of their families. If you think back to the story of David, he was the youngest of all the boys, and it was his job to watch the sheep because nobody else wanted to. These were those who probably had the least inheritance from their families, if any, at all. It was a humble profession, being a shepherd. An overlooked profession, being a shepherd. As they huddled near the fire, keeping warm in the chilly Judean night on the higher hills around Bethlehem, a glow appears. And you might remember the glow we talked about last week with Mary. Once again, a glow appears and a form materializes in front of them, and an angel speaks to them and tells them of a baby who's been born that night in their hometown. And as he finished speaking, the whole sky lights up with a myriad of angels, and they say, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill for men."
Amen.
Glory to God. Glory, honor, praise, adoration. You know, we humans chase after these things. You probably watched at some point in your life a red carpet event. TV celebrities strut down the walkway flanked by shouting photographers, and every moment is choreographed, every smile is practiced, clothing, makeup, and consorts are planned down to the finest detail. Everything is designed to elevate the famous one. upon him, to build him up in the eyes of the people, to strengthen her reputation in the reporting of the press. The goal is to become greater, to grow in glory and honor. In this first century story, these angels cast a different vision. Glory to God in the highest. These words easily slip off our tongues without thinking. Glory to God in the highest. Why? Because God, the eternal God, has taken on the form of a servant. Because the creator of the universe has become a part of his creation. Because the eternal word became a zygote and planted itself in the womb of a young woman and now has been delivered in the room where animals dwelt. This is God glorified. Humanity seeks glory by elevation. God was glorified by descending. God, the eternal word, through whom all was created and all exists, became one of us. Not only that, he was born to commoner parents, and no royalty greeted him, by the way. The only dignitaries who welcomed him were Gentiles who didn't fully understand the ways of God. In this, God was glorified. Honor and glory in God's kingdom is different than our society. In order to become great in his kingdom, one must become less. And in this, Jesus took the first step. He showed us the way, but the angels weren't done yet. Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests. Peace is a beautiful idea. The lack of strife and warfare creates opportunity for growth and development. Areas of the world that experience long-lasting conflicts, such as Afghanistan, Sudan, and others, suffer greater humanitarian displacement, depressed economies, destruction of infrastructure, and limited access to health care. Peace is a wonderful blessing, and we should be working toward that end in this world. But this is not what the angels are talking about. These angels were not declaring peace between people, groups, and nations. They're not stating that an end to geopolitical conflict. There's a greater conflict happening. This conflict is one that we are all engaged in. Because of sin, we are naturally at war with God, opposed to his will, and fighting against his government. But God so loved this rebellious world that he sent his only begotten Son so that anyone who trusts and believes in him should not perish in this war, but have peace with God and eternal life. This is the peace that the angels were singing about. This is the message that they came to bring. That through Christ's incarnation, through his becoming one of us, because he would succeed where Adam and Eve failed, we could have peace with God. Paul says in Romans chapter 5, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God.
Amen.
Because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us.
Amen.
You can have peace with God.
Amen.
No matter what you've done, or how you've rebelled, or the mistakes you've made, because Jesus came to this world, because he became one of us, he died for us to reclaim us to himself, you can have peace with God. Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests.
Amen.
Amen. Would you pray with me? Oh, Lord God, thank you for coming to this world. Thank you for glorifying yourself by ascending to be with us. Thank you for bringing your peace to our lives, for reconciling us to yourself through your incarnation, through your death, and your resurrection. We celebrate that today and always. Fill this church with your presence, I pray. I pray that you would draw us to yourself and fill us with your peace. We love you, and we're looking forward to seeing you. Thank you for joining us for this time of worship and celebration of Christ's incarnation and this Christmas story. I pray that you are blessed this Christmas week, that you are filled with the Spirit and enjoy time with your loved ones. Happy Sabbath.